One of the topics we're often asked about at CoEvolve is zero trust networking, and this whole concept of moving away from a traditional network perimeter to an environment where all user traffic is treated as untrusted. And I wanted to spend a few minutes today talking about how that applies to a lot of the network environments that we see on a regular basis, particularly environments where there's already an adoption of next generation technology like SD-WAN. So the key concept with Zero Trust is moving from a model where you focus on sites and locations on the network to one where you focus on the users. And there's a traditional concept in how you build enterprise networks where you really focus on that outer perimeter of the network. So you focus on firewalls and you focus on intrusion detection, and you build a very hardened perimeter around the outside of the network. But for most enterprises, once you're inside that perimeter, it's treated as an open network. And this is true for branch office connectivity, where if you connect to a router or inside of a router at a branch office site, you can then connect from that point to any other location on the network, to data centers, hub sites, headquarters, even other branch sites in many other networks. It's also true for traditional remote access solutions, where you build an IPsec or SSL tunnel into the network, and that allows the user to gain access to any of the resources that sit inside that perimeter. So the concept was always very much around the inside versus outside of the network. And there was far less focus placed on the individual users. So an individual user connecting at an office, whether they were in the IT department or the finance department or HR department, their network access would be essentially identical in each case. They could have access at the application level to different services, but the network was generally seen as a routed IP network that would connect each of the locations on the network. What we're seeing in a zero trust model is a rapid shift away from that approach. So instead of treating the network perimeter as stretching all the way out to the edges of the network, you eliminate that completely and you only focus on hardening a very core central part of the network where you've got all of your infrastructure, maybe it's Active Directory, maybe it's some other authentication infrastructure, and then everything outside of that is treated as an untrusted environment. So think about the guest network that you may have at a branch office today. The assumption in a zero trust model is that all of your enterprise users would actually sit on something approximating that network instead of the trusted network. From a network connectivity perspective, that user gains no access to other IP addressing spaces and other resources that sit on that network. What you do instead is you focus on a user model and you grant permissions at a user level to say these specific users or these specific groups are allowed to access these applications under this policy. And that becomes a policy that's attached to the user and their identity. And that identity can come from Active Directory, it can come from an external source like Okta or Duo, but it's tied to that user. And if that user is connecting at a branch office, that's the policy they get. If the user is connecting from home, that's the same policy that they get. If they're connecting from a hotel or a coffee shop, again, the policy is tied to the user so that it doesn't matter where they're connecting from. The assumption is that they're connecting from an untrusted source and you focus all of your permission granting on that user as opposed to the IP address or the range of IP addresses that they're connecting from. So in a model where there is already the adoption of a technology like SD-WAN, the question that's often asked as a follow-up is, well, do I still need zero trust or do I need to look at this type of zero trust model or flip it around completely? Do I still need SD-WAN if I'm adopting a zero trust model? So our view on this is that the two technologies can actually coexist pretty well. So an SD-WAN network is really good at aggregating connectivity, whether it's broadband, you know, commodity connectivity like that, 4G, 5G connectivity, and abstracting all of that underlay away from the network that's built across the top of it. That's still a really valid capability to have, even if you're in a zero trust environment, because you want users that are clustered together in a branch office to have reliable, sustainable connectivity. You want to have failover if the fixed line connectivity goes down to be able to use 4G instead. You may want to be able to bond together multiple connections in order to get the quality from a throughput and quality perspective that you need. So in this scenario, it can still make a lot of sense to maintain an SD-WAN environment where you gain the underlay aggregation component. You also gain the overlay capabilities. You gain the configuration management. You gain the optimizations that are performed at the overlay level. You also gain visibility around the health and performance of the network, that all of the traditional benefits that come with SD-WAN. In a zero trust model, it can also make sense to use the SD-WAN environment as a mechanism to connect traffic from devices and other pieces of infrastructure on the network that can't necessarily participate in a zero trust environment. So there could be legacy devices, there could be printers and cameras and other security devices on the network. They need a traditional network to operate effectively. So the SD-WAN can also carry that traffic between the locations on the network where it needs to connect. So moving away from the traditional security perimeter for the users doesn't necessarily need to mean the same thing is applied for every type of device on the network. You can very easily operate a two-tier approach, especially with SD-WAN, where you maintain some level of site-to-site connectivity for the legacy devices that need it, but users that can operate in a zero-trust environment can be moved out of that trusted perimeter and into the untrusted environment, with the connectivity then tied to their user credentials and the access tied to their user credentials. There's also a really important factor related to the types of locations that make up the network. There's a really significant difference between a large corporate office with key cards required for entry, lots of physical security to monitor and control who comes in and out of the building, lots of systems in place to monitor what's actually happening from a network perspective, policies to control turning on and turning off network ports throughout the building, and a very high level overall security level in place. And at the other end of the spectrum, you've got small branch offices that may have 5 to 6 people. They usually won't have any IT staff on site, and there's usually very little control or visibility from an enterprise perspective around who is connecting to the network in those environments. These are the types of locations where it's very easy for a third party to connect a network cable, an Ethernet cable, into the network. And in a traditional network, that gives them access from an IP perspective to the entire environment. They can start running vulnerability scans, they can start to discover other devices on the network and so on. And it's a very easy entry point into the network. These are the types of locations that are often seen as effectively the low-hanging fruit for potential intruders into the network because of that fact that they have very little in terms of physical and logical security systems in place. These locations can also become a really attractive place to start looking at a pilot of zero-trust technology. You can remove the concept of the network perimeter altogether from these sites and instead only have an untrusted environment there where you're authenticating the users, allowing them certain access to applications and infrastructure that they need, and everything else is blocked or denied in that scenario. Finally, I wanted to speak about the migration process that enterprises could look at in terms of adopting this type of technology. And the key point is that this does not need to be a big bang approach. You don't need to go all the way from a traditional network perimeter, even using SD-WAN, to a zero trust environment overnight. It's very feasible to take a subset of the network, take a selection of users or take a selection of sites, and then pilot this to determine how effectively the technology works in your environment. This is the type of work that we've already started helping some of our clients with, and there's still a lot of potential there for enterprises to gain some of the benefits and gain a good understanding of how the technology performs and behaves in their environment before going too far down the path of adopting it across the board. So hopefully this was helpful. This is a topic that is starting to become really relevant in a lot of our clients' networks today, and it's something that we're very happy to help map out a future state and then help manage the adoption of the technology into that future state as well. So thanks for listening, and if you have any questions, please let me know. Thank you.